Good afternoon, and thank you everyone for being here. When I proposed this topic of this talk to my team, the look that I got from them was the same look that a six-year-old gets when they say, I want to be Iron Man. And then the adults in the room understand the impossibility and the humor of that statement, but then they turn around and say, you can be whosoever you want. That was exactly the reception that I got from the team when I said, let's talk about LLMs at SSP. This was early Feb. We had already started exploring this thing called ChatGPT, but then we expanded our exploration to other LLMs as well. And then somebody else asked the question, what gives us the credibility to talk about it? And that was a very good question. I don't know whether we have the credibility, whether we are credible in that area or not. But then the reality is very few people are qualified to talk about it, but there are enough opinions that are going around. And opinions devoid of groundwork are just statements, are just extreme statements, to be honest. So in today's session, we are largely going to talk about LLMs as a technology. And the time spent by our teams over the last 4 to 5 months gives us some credibility to talk about it. Does that make us experts? No, we are not experts. But we have explored this enough to talk about it at a level of detail where we can kind of explain what this thing is and how it works. We will also talk about the broad question of fear versus celebration, and that we will do because we have got the same questions going through our mind. How will this impact our business? When will this impact our business? How will this impact our jobs? So we will share our personal thought process, perhaps mixed slightly with how we see the industry evolving in this. And the answer to this question isn't a binary yes or no. It depends is likely to be the more accurate response to this question. So let me start with a profoundly philosophical poem. We asked Google Bard, which is another LLM, to write a poem that we can use at SSP to talk to the audience about the impact of LLM on the STM industry. And this is what it says. And I'm sure the original Bard Shakespeare will be very, very proud of this creativity. And this kind of summarizes our talk as well today. Let me also introduce my colleagues real quick. Ravi is our strategic business director. He's based in Toronto and he comes with a rich publishing and technology consulting background. Ravi has been exploring the sentiments that are evolving around this technology. We also have a late participant. Neil is a product specialist at TNQ. And along with a team of very smart and highly motivated people, he has been exploring the kind of the underbelly of this technology. And as the session developed, we thought he is better placed to talk about the specifics of the session, but more importantly, take any difficult questions. In today's session, I'm going to be asking them a series of prepared questions, which will set the flow of the session as well. We had hoped to make the session interactive, but then as we were preparing for it, we realized 30 minutes wasn't enough to talk about this topic. So it is possible we may have time for a couple of questions at the end of it, but if not, we'll be out there to continue this discussion forward. So technology, a little late on that slide. So technology, any new and disruptive technology, it takes the human mind through a series of emotions. That has happened throughout history, from the discovery of fire to electricity to the internet. And by making that statement, I am implying that we believe generative AI will have the same effect on humanity as some of these prominent things or events that happen. The first emotion is curiosity, and curiosity leads to a lot of excitement. Excitement leads to a lot of discussions, but those discussions are laced with assumptions, anecdotes, hearsay, and very little fact and data, which then leads to a lot of apprehensions because fear spreads easily. And then a few mavericks and early adopters will take this technology and use it to great effect in their own small ways. And that gets everybody thinking about what this technology is, and that leads to exploration. Once we start exploring any technology which will have a tremendous impact, that leads to public debate. So policymakers, governments, industry leaders, all of them throw their opinions in the ring. As you were settling in, we had asked you to tell us what word represents your feeling when you think about ChatGPT. And it is slightly different to what I had expected. I had expected that bulk of the response will be exploration, but actually bulk of the response is curiosity. So we are still curious about this as a technology, and hopefully today we'll be able to discuss how the evolution has moved on from curiosity to excitement and leading to debate. Let me get my first question to Ravi. Ravi, in the last 5 years, we had barely understood what artificial intelligence and machine learning is, and we have barely started using it in our environment. And now there is this new thing called LLM. In simple terms, can you tell us, help us understand what a LLM is and how is it different from AI and ML?
Sure, Ravi. So first of all, let me tell you that LLMs are audible, right? Yeah. So LLMs are not new. You may be surprised to know they have been around for a while. It's just that with the release of ChatGPT, everybody is talking about it because of its human-like conversational capability. And I know this audience know LLM stands for large language model, and that's where the clue lies of its linkage to AI/ML. So let's dissect this. AI is a larger, broader field, artificial intelligence. We see it in movies, and it automates human tasks, and it mimics human intelligence to a degree. And then we have machine learning on the other hand, which trains machines on large set of data for a specific outcome or specific task. And then to understand LLMs, we also have to introduce one more term, NLP, natural language processing. And that's what it gives the capability to interact in a human-like language and also respond with that output. So LLM is a specific implementation of AI/ML, where ML is intersecting with NLP. So I think you can see it on the slide. But very importantly, two keywords I would like to emphasize. One is large. And why large? Because it's trained on large set of data, almost entire internet. For GPT-3, it's 17 gigs of data. For GPT-4, it's 45 gigs of data. And this will keep on increasing. Like it will turn into terabytes of data at some point in time when we see GPT-20. Anyway, the second keyword is language because of its NLP capability I just mentioned. So in essence, GPT is a ML model, which is trained on large set of data, but also has NLP-like capability, and it's generating human-like output. And that's why it's called generative AI. Right. So just to summarize, I was at CSC annual conference in Toronto, and I really like Avi Steinman's quote there. He mentioned GPT is like solving Wordle on steroids.
Very, very interesting, Ravi. So maybe another way to think about ChatGPT is to use an analogy. Imagine you are at a party and you meet somebody there who has consumed or read all of the books and all of the materials that is publicly available on the internet across the world. But not just that, they also have the ability to remember everything that they have heard. They also have the ability to make connections between unrelated pieces of information. But more importantly, they understand the nuance of every language that they read. Nuance is very important. They're not reading it just as words and statements. They are able to read it and understand it within the context of what was being said. And then when they are asked a question, any question, they're able to go through this vast amount of information and come up with a very meaningful response. And you know, in ChatGPT, you can interact with it. So when you interact and you are able to counter any information that they have provided, they also learn from you, unlike knowledgeable people who sometimes get defensive, but they learn from you. The challenge right now still is it hallucinates a little bit, meaning...
Abhi, I guess he's at a party, so you know, a little bit of hallucination is allowed.
Yes, but not necessarily when... people are depending on the response or want to depend on the response, then hallucination is a problem. But let's get a little deeper and bring in Neil. So Neil, all of this recent development stems from a paper that was published by a few Google researchers in 2017, and the paper was titled, Attention is All You Need. What does that mean?
Oh, that's a landmark paper you are referring to, Abhi. And this paper, Attention is All You Need, was written by Ashish Vaswani and his team at Google Brain. And that has truly shaken things up because they introduced the concept of transformers to the world. And we must give credit where it's due because Google did not hide it behind a patent, but they made it open for everyone to benefit from and build upon it. And the result, we see that there has been an explosion of LLMs all around us, and all of them use this concept. Now, without getting into technicalities, let me say LLMs like GPT are generative pre-trained transformers. So I'll use your analogy because who doesn't like a good analogy? So there are three key things which makes this transformer so special. First one being its ability to do parallel processing. So let's say this person is at a party and they're able to listen to all of the conversations at the same time without missing a beat. So yes, everything together, all at the same time, without missing anything, which means it's able to parallelly process everything. And that's in contrast to the previous models which we had of machine learning, which could listen to only one thing or maybe a few at best, right? So that's one. Second, attention mechanism, which also relates to this paper's title, that this person is not just listening to multiple conversation, it's also able to focus on the most meaningful and relevant parts of the discussion. Amidst all the noise, it's able to filter out what is meaningful and relevant. And now how does it benefit? When someone asks a question to this model or this person, it's able to remember all of the conversations, it understands questioner's intent, ties it back to the part of the conversation which might be the most relevant, bring it back, and then give a response which is far more nuanced, right? So that's attention mechanism. Third one is its ability to do transfer learning or transfer its learning. So this person is also, with every single conversation or every party it goes, it keeps learning from it and apply it to the present conversation which it is having. So if this person goes to whether a party or bar or at home or office, it is always learning and using all of that into the present context. So those are the three things of about transformer which make it truly special: parallel processing, attention mechanism, and transfer learning.
And so Neil, let me interject. So amongst these three abilities that you highlight of this person, which one is most important for the development of LLM?
Right. So Ravi, let me say, attention mechanism is the most foundational of it for large language models, because it gives these machine learning models the ability to understand the context and semantics of it, which makes this model, it adds depth to it. In contrast, the other two mechanisms which I spoke about, parallel processing, it makes the model training very efficient and very, very cheap, and transfer learning makes it very adaptable. But attention mechanism is what is adding depth to it, which results into the kind of output which we see.
Right. So that right there is perhaps the most important part of understanding what makes LLMs very, very powerful. So we'll explain, Neil. Ravi, we keep talking about ChatGPT, but are there other LLM models that we should know of?
Sure, Ravi. So I think it's a very diverse landscape, as we all know. Every now and then there is a new model popping up in the market, and there are significant implementations of this model which is creating the buzz. But let's look at some prominent ones which we have highlighted. It's segregated into proprietary or commercial models, then open source models, and there are certain application focused ones. So we know that ChatGPT is a proprietary model. It's closed, it hallucinates. It's sort of like a black box because we don't know what data has been used for training and how it is generating the output. So it's completely black box. And there is bias in that data, in the output. Another proprietary one is Claude from Anthropic, which puts AI safety at forefront. So they don't claim to be be all, end all of all the models. And then there are some open source models which we know of, like Llama from Facebook, BERT from Google. And these are prominent for research and development of this discipline.
In fact, Ravi, we use BERT model at TNQ for our language processing.
That's correct. And then the application focused one, I would like to highlight CyBERT, which is based on BERT from Google. And they trained on 1 million articles, scientific articles, and you can use it to query science basically. So it's an entire gamut. And I think I also want to give a special mention to Firefly. Firefly came up 6 weeks ago and it's from Adobe. They have all sort of data from Photoshop. So it's generating image on basis of certain keywords. So it's a nightmare, but it's very powerful. It's very powerful in terms of generating image.
Right. I've seen Adobe Firefly and it is magical, but our keynote session from Elizabeth Bick is about research integrity. And for people who are concerned about research integrity, image integrity, I can tell you Adobe Firefly will be a huge nightmare. But Ravi, continuing with you, I saw a couple of weeks ago that Sam Altman, the CEO of OpenAI, was called for a congressional hearing, and he made a couple of very confusing statements. But can you tell us what public speakers are talking about AI in general?
Yeah, so I think before I talk about prominent voices, there is a meme going around in the market that even kids are rhyming, "Old MacDonald had a farm, AI, AIO." Anyway, so coming to Sam Altman, in his congressional hearing, he said AI is dangerous for society.
And when did he realize that? Before releasing it in public domain or after releasing it?
I guess that he was just being politically correct. That's the point, right? He was being politically correct and he was avoiding any damage on his corporation for large scale misuse. But he did say that guardrails are required for adoption of AI in the society. And the most interesting statement he made was that people should be happy because we are scared of it. I mean, it's such a confusing statement, like kind of go figure, right? So this is the transition Abhi talked about, like from exploration to debate. And that debate is happening constantly. Like countries are getting involved. Italy banned the use of GPT, right?
Although they resumed that again after they complied to OpenAI policies. In fact, EU is already working on GDPR-like legislation for AI. And even in US, people are discussing about it.
Right. And probably, I think legislation is needed to prevent misuse of the AI.
Right. And what you see on the screen, this is the most recent news that has come up. The Center for AI Studies has released a statement from people like Sam Altman, Jeffrey Hinton, Demis Hassabe, who is the mind behind Google DeepMind. And what is most interesting is that these guys are comparing the threat of AI with other extinction events like nuclear wars, which is a massive escalation in a very short span of time. And I am bewildered as to how the same people who have been working on AI for decades are now making doomsday prophecies. And that makes me wonder whether some of these concerns are real, and they very well might be, or are they designed to protect big firms and prevent competition? I know I'm reaching here, but you know, who knows? Nevertheless, nobody is saying don't use it. Nobody is saying don't use it in its current form. So everybody is talking about restraint and regulation. So the technology is here to stay, no doubt. Perhaps we can use it in some low-risk areas. I was speaking with a publisher just before coming to this session, and they are considering using ChatGPT for their author-centric workflows. They are considering using it for customer service. Of course, they will have to further train the pre-trained model with their own data. But that is a use case very similar to Anthropic's cloud. But let's go back to technology a little bit. So Neil, in your understanding beyond these doomsday prophecies, what are some of the real concerns in terms of technology of using LLMs today? And what would your advice be if I want to use LLM within TNQ?
Well, Abhi, my first advice will be that you look at the budget and you will know how much we are already spending on exploring LLM within TNQ.
Yeah.
Well, coming back to concerns. So there are some standard concerns related to any new technology like performance, scalability, integration with existing systems. But those are the concerns which the commercial models can well take care of. But when it comes to the context of scientific research and publishing in specific, ethics and legality, as we all know, and we have been discussing, that comes to the top. And these have so vast and complex implications that it becomes a difficult problem to solve. So that's the first one up there.
Right. I think the industry is also reacting to it. No, I mean, the STM industry hasn't reacted this fast. I was in a session earlier where there was a poll and people said that this industry is very slow to react to it, but on this technology, this industry is reacting very fast to the technology. And
but Abhi, I shall also highlight the gist of everyone's thinking around this area is Science Journal came up with a quote that ChatGPT is fun, but not an author. Because it's very difficult to draw the line where GPT is being used, whether it's for outsourced thinking or just for paraphrasing, right? And It's a very thin line, and there are no tools available as such that can detect usage of GPT. I mean, if you're processing a language, it's very hard to tell where it came from.
That's right. That's right, Ravi. And I think as technology evolves and legislations come in, it would demand policies within publishing industry as well. And we know that these kind of problems are very difficult to solve. So it demands a lot of discussion and policy making.
Right. And I think from what I heard from COPE and STM Association, they both are working right now to define the guidelines and policies around ethical use of AI and specifically LLM. So we will see in the industry some guidance coming out.
But the challenge there is the definition of ethics itself. Who defines the ethics? What is the bias that they carry in defining the ethics? And how do you come up with a guardrail that is going to be consistent and universally acceptable? Because it depends from culture to culture. It differs from culture to culture. But Neil, carry on.
Yeah, no, exactly. Because collaboration is needed in the industry, because then only we can have universally accepted guardrails rather than doing in isolation. Well, coming back to the concerns. So after ethics and legality, quality is again a very, very important consideration, because many of us in the room might have used ChatGPT and we know it hallucinates. And the worst part is we don't even know where it hallucinates. And when we are talking about scientific research, is that something which is acceptable? No. So quality becomes an important consideration there. And there's one more interesting thing which I discovered recently, that all of these large language models, they are trained using unsupervised learning, which means that data has just been fed to it. Now, the impact of that is, for example, when you ask a particular question, the way this model would work, it will give more weightage to the papers which have been cited more. Now, again, is that a bias which is acceptable to us? So that's that. And again, the one big problem with ChatGPT has been that it's sort of a black box. We don't know where the responses are coming from. So while it gives you some response, we don't know whether it's cooking it up or it's actually referring to a credible resource, because you don't know. So again, that absence of explainability, we don't know. So that's another issue there. Plus, we have data privacy, because all what we do in scientific research and publishing is IP sensitive. So the safety, privacy, and security of our data becomes one key consideration. We, as part of this exploration, we have been playing with OpenAI's API. And there's one thing which we have learned through this exploration is that it is very, very expensive. The way this model works, their pricing model works, they have a token-based pricing, and what they call token, for sake of simplicity, you can think of it as every word. So which means you are paying for every single word which is getting processed through it, either feeding to it or it is giving it back to you. So
not just that, even the questions that are being asked are also something that is being charged for.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
So those are important considerations. Of course, there is a need to understand the risk, but surely there are opportunities as well. Maybe for large scale adoption, it might be better to wait until things becomes clearer, until regulations come in. But you know, as we've said earlier, the genie is out of the bag anyway. Before we ask Ravi for some industry specific consideration, Neil, can you quickly explain how you have tried to use ChatGPT within TNQ?
Right. So it's in early stages of exploration. While we have been using Google's BERT model for our language processing for a while, ChatGPT is something which we have lately been exploring for specific use cases. So the first step is the model selection. Which model do we choose? And that's a function of the use case. What problem do we want to solve with it? Right. So base model selection becomes the first step. Second up is training that model, the base model, with our own data, right? Because then that makes it more contextual within our ecosystem. So training a model is the second step. And that is where it becomes very interesting. The previous machine learning model which we had were mere algorithms. It did not have any data. And going back to GPT, generative pre-train, which means it's already trained with a huge amount of data. And because it's coming with that data already, we only have to feed that minimal amount of delta data to it, which makes it very, very efficient, very cheap as well, right? So we select the model, we train with our own data. Third, although it is black box, but thankfully they do give us some parameters, or what they call as hyperparameters, to tweak some of its settings. So for example, there is a setting called temperature, which creates, which basically controls the creativity quotient of the model. So for most of the use cases where you want it to give a little more consistent responses, more relevant responses, you will keep that setting to very low. But if you want it to be very flamboyant and start giving you very creative responses, you might want very high setting for this temperature.
That temperature setting is likely to be the most favorite setting of paper mill agents.
Well, if only there was a setting for integrity and not fabrication, Abhi. But yeah, that's what it is. So coming back to it, many of you, if you have used ChatGPT, you would have given it some instruction, you would have asked it a question, it would have gave you back something, you might have not been very happy with it, you might have tweaked your instruction or question and back and forth, to a point where you are okay with the response. So essentially what you have done is prompt engineering, and that has become a popular lingo right now, right? So coming from model selection and training and hyperparameters, now prompt engineering becomes important because now your model is ready. Now, what do you want it to do? So you come up with a set of instructions and craft it in such a way that it gives you the most optimal responses in a most cost-efficient way. So just like we all had to learn user experience to deal with the digital ecosystem around us, we also will have to learn prompt engineering for doing our tasks and all our roles. And then lastly, there is also reinforcement learning, not a new concept, but because these are all machine learning models, there could be certain cases where you want this model to continuously keep learning from the user feedback, be it positive or negative. So there you go.
Right. So this will require a bit more explanation, and perhaps we can continue this conversation outside this room. But for people who need even more information than what Neil can provide, this slide will guide you as to where you can seek help. Oops. This is where you can go and seek more help about learning about AI. But before we conclude, one final question for Ravi. There are wider usage of LLMs within the industry, any business, okay? For example, software development will drastically change because LLMs have the capability of generating small pieces of code, creating framework, creating test cases. That will not eliminate developers, that will not take away their jobs, but that will kind of give them wings. Content marketing, all of these creative activities will also change because these GPT models are very good at generating creative output. So there is change across business. It is not very specific to content. But why don't you, Ravi, tell us what you think LLMs will do for the STM industry? And bearing in mind that in the STM industry, the value chain is divided into content creation, content moderation, content production, and delivery.
Right. So I think, Abhi, this is a very wide topic, and I'm sure audience is already deliberating about it and thinking deeply, probably no more than us. At this stage, but there are tremendous opportunities in research itself, in the way research is being conducted. So do you want to touch upon that? And then I'll come to.
Okay. So I don't know, some of you know that we work very closely with the Indian research ecosystem. We work very closely with the researchers and authors in India. And what we have learned based on these conversations are that there are tremendous opportunities within research itself. And all of these things are being used already, by the way. So researchers are using ChatGPT to supplement the role of mentors. Now, if you think about a young researcher, one of the most difficult things that they face is framing the question of their research for their thesis and dissertation. What should be the right question that I would conduct my research on to further science? And that is a very difficult thing to do, and that requires mentorship, but mentorship is not easily available. But as ChatGPT evolves, or as GPTs evolve, you will be able to have a conversation with ChatGPT as a mentor and come to a conclusion of what should be the research topic. You can use LLMs to design experiments where it will suggest you the relevant variables, relevant methodologies, relevant techniques. And one of the most important things that somebody told me they're already using it for is statistical analysis of very complex data. So these are three things that researchers are already using for. So even before we come to publishing, there is use in the author domain of this ChatGPT, and how that will come to us We don't even know. We don't understand that impact as yet. Because these are all very time-consuming tasks that require very specialized skills that may not be available to these young researchers. So I believe this might significantly increase the speed of research, and this might also significantly increase the volume of research content. So over to you, Ravi.
So I think I'll provide flavor of each of these four stages based on what we have been hearing and reading. On the creation side, where authors and researchers are creating artifacts, GPT can actually support significantly to researchers. And we already know researchers from ESL countries are already using GPT to polish the language and edit the language. And it is leading to better submission. In the moderation stage, peer review happens, and there is tremendous opportunity. And I think it can revolutionize our approach. Bearing in mind there are risks involved and there are ethics involved for the peer review, but it can help in extracting key results, generating summaries, and even identifying gaps within research. It's a far-fetched dream, but the way these models are evolving, we don't know. I think in 6 months or 1 year, we will see this evolution happening. In the production stage, which involves structuring, copy editing, and typesetting, we believe this AI ML adoption will expedite in the workflow. And especially author service and customer support, there is a direct connection there, and it will be like chatbots on steroids.
But and bear in mind, there is already a lot of technology and automation that exists in the production space. There is already enough. So we will have to see what LLMs can do on top of it and retain the efficiency and retain the quality. And this is also a gentle message for all of our customers here. We will have to take a little bit of time to understand this and implement this.
Right. And I think finally, on the distribution side, GPT can help us create accessible content and also easy to read and consumable content for general public. The complex articles can be converted into those summaries. So there you have it, Abhi. I think these are just glimpses of use cases that will be impacted by the use of GPT. And we cannot cover all, but PubMed, we know, came up with BERT-based model. And we are yet to assess it. We are yet to see the impact on the industry. And I think the way you were describing these four stages, the biggest impact we will see on the creation and the moderation, that we can definitely see, that content creation and moderation will have biggest impact.
And before that, the research itself.
The actual research.
So it'll start from there. Okay, thank you, Ravi. So this is a very wide topic. And as you said, the audience will know more, so we can continue this discussion outside this room as well. We are out of time, so let me quickly wrap this up. I don't think we know enough to answer the question of whether ChatGPT will take away our jobs or not. But history tells us that a technology this significant has the potential of changing jobs and forcing us to evolve. And that surely needs to be treated as an opportunity rather than a threat. There is a need for caution. And you have seen what people behind this technology are saying. We saw the quotes from all of these guys. But the question is not so much about ChatGPT being right or wrong. In our minds, the question is about the usefulness of this technology, just like the usefulness of any technology. Even in cases where LLMs cannot provide you with the full solution, they will have the ability to provide you with a significant starting point. But the disclaimer there is trust, but verify. That's true for humans. That's also true for ChatGPT. So if I have to make some recommendations, based on my own personal opinion, I'll make 5 recommendations. Number one, do not ignore this technology. This has the potential of fundamentally changing not just work and work processes, but the nature and scope of businesses. So do not ignore this technology. Second, do not also assume that this technology is a replacement of your core processes, because by design, it has and it will continue to have flaws in its output, which will always require human intervention. So this is not likely to replace everything. Third, do not leave this exploration to somebody else. This is not like a simple application or a product that will work around you. In the future, we may have to work around this product. So get your hands dirty, no matter what your role or your job is. Fourth, do not rely on one-sided opinions. People are being extreme about it, and there are many statements that are flowing through. Keep your mind open to threats. but also look at the opportunities that exist and keep yourself informed. But the most important recommendation is this. This is such a huge thing that the entire publishing industry has to come together. This cannot be a fragmented discussion. It cannot be about individual policies, because if the entire industry does not come together, the research integrity and paper mill-like threats and many other threats that we can't even imagine right now will become even more prevalent and even more significant. I will highlight one issue, the issue of paper mills, which is an example. It is the perfect example where the industry and all publishers should have come together. But that did not happen. There was a common enemy, and still we all did not come together. And everybody is acting on their own and solving this problem individually, which is only giving more power to these threat agents. So I don't know if it is possible for the industry to come together, but I think that's the only way to deal with the threat of LLMs and ChatGPT. Opportunities can be varied depending on the vision and mission and the maturity of every organization. But the threats are common, and therefore they need to be dealt with together. With that note, I don't know if we have time for questions, but we will be right there. If you have any questions, technical questions, Neil is there. If you have any questions about how we are using it, Shanti is there. If you have any questions about weather or the nightlife of Portland, I'll be there. But thank you so much for attending this session. We'll talk to you outside.